and academia to further educate ourselves about these markets. And as we develop laws and regulations establishing guardrails and rules of the road for market participants, we do so in a transparent and clear manner so everyone knows what those rules are. Thank you, Madam Chair. I look forward to today's discussion, and with that, I yield back.
Well, thank you very much, and welcome back, Chairman Benham, and congratulations on your unanimous Senate confirmation. You're no stranger to the Agriculture Committee, as we all know. Chairman Benham has extensive experience with financial and agricultural markets. During his tenure as a CFTC chair and commissioner, he has been on the forefront of issues critical to global market stability. Chairman Benham was one of the first financial regulators to ring the alarm on the climate crisis. He's created a dedicated climate unit at the agency focused on addressing the significant risks climate change poses to the financial system. The CFTC also has significant experience regulating digital asset derivatives and prosecuting fraud and abuse in digital asset markets. Given the increasing size and scope of the market for digital assets, many of which are commodities, we are looking to the CFTC to advise us on how to best protect consumers and markets. So I look forward to getting your perspective, Mr. Chairman, on the benefits and risks prevented by these emerging technologies and the role of the Commission in regulating this market. So I will turn it over to you for opening comments, and then we'll look forward to questions. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Chairwoman Stabenow. Good morning to both you, Chairwoman Stabenow, Ranking Member Bozeman, and members of the committee. I'm honored to appear before you today for the first time as Chairman of the Commodity Futures Trading Commission. I appreciate the opportunity to share my views on digital assets and look forward to working with this committee as we collectively address the many issues related to this emerging technology. For over a century, the derivatives markets have played an integral role in the U.S. economy, facilitating risk management and price discovery and contributing to financial stability and predictability of prices that impact the daily lives of all Americans. As part of the CFTC's role in ensuring the integrity of derivatives markets, the agency understands a great deal about underlying reference cash markets, where producers, including farmers and ranchers, manufacturers, institutional investors, directly exchange agricultural commodities, energy products, precious metals, and even digital assets. While the CFTC does not have direct statutory authority to regulate cash markets, it does have fraud and manipulation authority. Accordingly, when the CFTC becomes aware of potential fraud or manipulation in an underlying market, either through regular oversight or surveillance programs, or through other means such as a whistleblower tip or referral, we address the misconduct through our enforcement authority. This is not to diminish the fact that many cash commodity markets benefit from federal oversight. However, the digital asset market, which at present is most directly supervised through state money transmitter licenses, is unique and presents many novel issues for the CFTC, given our limited authority to police these volatile markets. In fact, there is no one regulator, either state or federal, with sufficient visibility into digital asset commodity trading activity to fully police conflicts of interest and deceptive trading practices that impact retail investors. Although the CFTC's core responsibility is regulating the commodity derivatives market, there are several unique elements of the digital asset commodity cash market that distinguish it from other cash commodity markets, suggesting it would benefit greatly from more CFTC oversight. A few examples. Unlike most cash commodity markets, the cash market for digital assets is currently characterized by a high number of retail investors, mostly engaged in price speculation. Many investors regularly take on high levels of leverage when trading, leading to heightened price volatility, often exacerbated by cascading liquidations during price downturns. Most investors in the cash market entrust their digital assets to the platforms upon which they trade, failing to differentiate this type of custody arrangement from that offered by traditional regulated banking industry participants. I believe these unique characteristics, combined with the growing size and customer, operational, and potential future financial stability risks associated with the cash market necessitate a proactive federal regulatory approach to ensure that the standards that American investors have come to expect from our financial markets are equally present in digital markets. If, in fact, the future global economy holds a place for digital assets, tokenization, blockchain technology, decentralized finance, and other elements of the fintech ecosystem, then the need to uphold American leadership and stewardship of this technology is clear. The digital asset industry in the U.S. does not fall under a single comprehensive regulatory regime. Instead, the CFTC and other federal agencies and state regulators have all been responsible for collectively establishing the existing and very incomplete regulatory environment. Since 2014, the CFTC has been aggressive in using its limited fraud and manipulation authority in the digital asset space. The CFTC has brought nearly 50 enforcement actions, overseen an increasing number of registrants offering digital asset-based derivatives products, and established dedicated internal functions to stay abreast of the technical innovations fueling this market. However, many challenges remain, and the digital sector now demands more and more of the CFTC's attention and time, which I believe necessitates additional resources to adequately address these issues and risks. The CFTC is well suited to play an increasingly central role in overseeing the cash digital asset commodity market. Fundamentally, the CFTC is a market regulator that ensures market integrity and vibrancy aimed at supporting financial stability, while ensuring individual customer protections through principles-based oversight of exchanges, clearinghouses, data repositories, and market participants. And we now stand ready to do the same within the digital asset commodity market. As chairman, I will ensure the CFTC continues to use our enforcement authority to its fullest extent in the digital asset commodity space to protect customers from fraud and manipulation. The nature of this innovation results in impacts to more than just financial markets. We are seeing several government agencies consider how this technology impacts federal policy related to payments, custody, illicit activity, national security, and a host of other issues. Additionally, reports regarding energy usage resulting from mining are staggering, oftentimes being compared to that of entire countries. On this note, I believe any regulatory response to digital assets must include measures to bring additional transparency to the conduct that makes this innovation possible. Internally, I have directed the CFTC's Climate Risk Unit and Lab CFTC to examine the climate implications of digital assets. Since its inception, the CFTC and its markets have been at the forefront of innovation and technological development. We have also been a forceful and disciplined cop on the beat. The continued emergence of digital asset technology presents risks and opportunities, and the CFTC stands ready to leverage its expertise and experience to confront both. Thank you for your time, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And so we will begin five-minute rounds of questioning from the committee. I do believe we have folks that are joining us, members joining us virtually as well. And so we look forward to everyone's questions. So let me first thank you for your response to the letter that we sent as chairs and ranking members of the House and Senate Agriculture Committees. I think it was important, as Senator Bozeman indicated, this was a significant sign that we had all four corners signing a letter to you and expressing, you know, interest in having more discussion with you on what the role is for the CFTC. And I would ask unanimous consent to enter your letter into the record. So ordered, without objection. In the letter, I was struck by your statement that it's hard to estimate how many U.S. and retail participants are trading digital assets because the agency has limited visibility into this market. So I wonder if you could talk more and describe the CFTC's ability to surveil the digital asset spot market for fraud and manipulation, and what implications this has right now for the agency.
Thank you, Senator. You're absolutely right that the authority is limited. It's limited to fraud and manipulation, and as I pointed out in my statement, this is a product of the relationship between derivatives markets and cash markets. We have a number of exchange-traded derivatives on crypto assets on several registered CFTC exchanges, but the visibility into the underlying market is limited at most. And we use our existing surveillance tools to work through some of the futures products and see if we can see participants, volumes, volatility. But in essence, this is an unregulated market. As I mentioned, we rely on state money transmitter licenses. But there is so much that we are not able to see because of this limited authority. I would point out the fact that the enforcement actions we've brought since going back to 2015 have largely relied on tips and whistleblowers. So in essence, we're relying on retail customers who are defrauded through Ponzi schemes or pump and dump schemes to bring information to us. We don't have the regular tools that we as a market regulator have in terms of pre-trade transparency, post-trade transparency, a concentrated order book, surveillance tools, market intelligence. We don't have any of these very advanced tools to monitor markets. So it's giving us a very, very narrow lens into what is actually happening in the market. And this is why I think, you know, as you contemplate more regulatory authority for the CFTC, bringing this market into the light, so to speak, and more transparency will only allow us to see what's going on underneath the hood.
I couldn't agree more. This is very concerning to me at the moment of, you know, the lack of transparency and ability to see what's happening. We're seeing an explosion also of advertisements marketing crypto assets to retail investors, and it's getting easier to buy and sell digital assets through apps on our phones. I'm concerned we're not doing enough to educate people about the risks of trading crypto assets, particularly under the scenario that you're describing in terms of limited oversight. What should Congress consider in terms of customer protections as these technologies reach more people?
Thank you, Senator. I would say, you know, at the onset, we're doing what we can with what we have. And in terms of customer protections, we're using our Office of Customer Education to put out brochures and pamphlets and mailings and alerts about some of the fraud and manipulation that's occurring, but also some of the risks that are involved with digital assets. But more importantly, and to more directly answer your question, the single best action that Congress can take to address customer protections is bringing a regulatory structure to this market. Not like any other market, whether it's securities or derivatives, market structure tends to be pretty singular in scope in the sense that, as I mentioned earlier in your previous question, if we can embed pre-trade transparency, post-trade transparency, which is reporting, having this concentrated order book where we can see bids and offers, and then having rules of the road for execution, for custody, for clearing, and for settlement, these are the main foundations and pillars of a well-functioning, transparent market. And in essence, the repercussions and the consequences of this are customer protections. It's visibility, it's information flow, so investors know how they're allocating their capital, and they can feel confident that as a regulator, we have enforcement authority and the rule of law to back us up if there is continued fraud or manipulation or anti-competitive behavior.
Thank you. Listening to you and what, from a consumer standpoint, as well as everyone involved in the market, but from a consumer standpoint, looking at what needs to be done to create the protections and so on, does the CFTC have the resources necessary to take on an additional responsibility with respect to the digital asset market?
Senator, the short answer is no. I can't precisely put a number on it, but I have thought about this quite a bit in the past few months. And I think the best sort of benchmark to think about is what the CFTC went through in the past 10 years after the financial crisis. As you know well, this committee gave authority to the CFTC to regulate the then over-the-counter derivatives markets. We now have brought swaps onto exchanges with a series of regulatory changes that have brought, again, pre-trade transparency and post-trade transparency to the swaps market. And just looking at numbers, in 2011, our budget appropriation was about $200 million, and now we're just slightly over $300 million. So depending on the size of the registrant pool that we may get if you were to authorize regulation of digital asset commodities, I would think at a minimum that $100 million mark is probably a starting point to look at as a reference.
Thank you very much. Senator Bozeman.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Chairman Benham, as you testified both today and during your confirmation hearing, you indicated that if Congress so decided, the CFTC would welcome expanded authority over digital asset spot markets. Why are current state-based regulations inadequate, and why do you believe CFTC is uniquely positioned to regulate the markets? Why you?
Thanks, Senator Bozeman. I'll tell you, as a former investigator at the Bureau of Securities in the New Jersey Attorney General's office, I will be the biggest advocate of state regulators within financial markets. They serve an invaluable tool for customers at the state level, whether it's customer protections, customer education, and certainly enforcement. But from a market regulatory standpoint, from a market oversight standpoint, I think it's very important that we have as few regulators as possible, we have as few little fragmentation as possible, and single points of entry into the market. Fragmentation will likely create price dislocations, we'll have different sets of rule books, which could, in the end, create risk for investors. So as we think about the role and the coordination between state and federal, I think there's a strong place for that. As I said, states play a key role in financial market stability and protecting customers. However, from a market standpoint, I think it's important, given the national scope of these markets, but the international scope, that we have single regulators at the federal level to be that single point of entry for market oversight, for surveillance, and for a level playing field so that everyone's playing from the same rules.
Mm-hmm. Should the CFTC be given an expanded role in regulating digital asset spot markets, how would you respond to any concern that this might open the door to future emission creep by the CFTC into traditional commodity spot markets, which I don't think would be appropriate or welcomed by myself or important ag stakeholders?
Thanks, Senator. I unequivocally agree with you. I don't mean to suggest at all that this should be the start of the CFTC's role in a larger pool of cash commodity markets. As I said in my statement, many cash commodities, including in the agricultural space and the energy space, have existing federal regulatory oversight to some extent. This particular market is so unique because of the retail-facing element of it, and the fact that there is no oversight currently. I think from a congressional standpoint, as we think about this going forward, there is a way to legislatively limit the expansion of authority for the CFTC and make very clear that the direction you're giving us is very limited, surgically limited, to just digital commodity assets and no other commodities.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Cybersecurity, particularly the safety of customer assets, continues to play a large role in conversations focusing on the digital asset markets. If the CFTC is given more regulatory authority over spot markets, what cybersecurity and customer protection measures could help combat vulnerabilities we've observed in this space?
Thank you, Senator. One of the things that I've been most impressed about as both commissioner and chairman is the role that we play collectively within the whole government in terms of cyber risks. We certainly take cues from agencies across the federal government, most notably DHS. We work together. We have a lot of partnerships to make sure that we're using the same tools and resources to the extent that we can root out cyber threats. I don't think this would be generally different if you were to give us more authority over the digital asset space in terms of our coordinating effort. One of the things that does concern me in terms of our current authority, as you pointed out, there just seems to be frequent thefts, cyber attacks that are causing, coins moving around in significant numbers. We would have to think about the relationship of the CFTC to third parties and the relationship between the registrant and whoever it relates to or enters into a contract with. This is synonymous to a third-party vendor. I think we'd be, as we think about potential legislation, ensuring that we have the right amount of authority to look through just the direct registrant and not necessarily only skim what cyber protections or what principles that registrant might be using. those are risks that I think we'd have to be very cognizant of addressing, given the nature of the technology and its international nature as well.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much. We will now turn to Senator Tuberville.
Thank you very much. Chairman, good to see you back. Congratulations on your confirmation. I appreciate your reply to my letter on the need to include state securities regulators in the digital asset working group. Thank you very much for that. I also appreciate you taking time to meet with the leadership of the Alabama Securities Commission, which I understand you'll be doing later this month. As you know, state regulators have valuable insights to offer. Question, we've got to make sure the dollar remains the world's reserve currency. Do we need to develop a digital dollar to do that?
Senator, I wouldn't want to jump to conclusions about whether or not that is the solution to maintaining the dollar as the reserve currency, but I do think what I'm hearing from my colleagues across the government, most notably the Fed, the Federal Reserve, is that we are in a process of thinking about how we would implement this. This is no, as you would imagine, no simple task, but as with all of this technology, we'll need to be very deliberate and cautious as we implement this technology into the traditional financial system. So I certainly support the efforts that are being made. I think the approach and strategy is correct, but I don't think we should rush to anything at this time. But depending on where this technology takes us, and I said this in my comment, we have to be prepared for it being a part of our larger macro and micro economy. And if it is in fact going to be that way in 5 years, 10 years, or longer, we need to prepare now. So I think the steps that my colleagues are taking over at the Federal Reserve and other agencies are appropriate, but I would just be mindful of the speed with which we do it and not getting into a race where we feel we have to catch up with other countries. We just, as we've done in the past, we've been deliberate, and I think that's proven to be a successful strategy for the United States.
Thank you. You know, I'm a believer that ever lawful business ought to have access to banking services. And I think you are too, regardless of the type of business they're in. For example, no oil or gas company or firearms manufacturer should be discriminated against when they're trying to open a bank account or get a loan. I've heard reports of regulators pressuring banks to cut off financial services to legitimate crypto businesses. Are you aware of this, and would you agree that it's wrong if it's happening?
Senator, short answer is I am not aware of this. However, I do think I agree with you that we should not be cutting off certain services from the traditional banking system. However, I firmly believe this. I think the record is pretty clear that I think we need to address the climate crisis as soon as possible, and that is a collective action problem. So as much as we shouldn't cut off companies or institutions or individuals from traditional banking services, I think we need to make individuals aware of what's coming and what we need to do to manage the transition risk of moving away from carbon-intensive energy sources.
How could foreign adversaries like China, Iran, and Russia use crypto-related cybercrimes to harm our citizens and our national interest? And what is your agency doing to address, you know, these threats?
Senator, this is a problem. I mean, this is the limited scope of visibility we have into the market. I would just point to, you may be aware, but the Justice Department just seized $3.5 billion of Bitcoin yesterday from a hack that occurred in 2016. I think the lessons from that announcement from the Justice Department are that this technology is traceable, that we can work through the web of sources and the movement of these funds, but it takes time. And that the technology is going to be incrementally improving over the next few years. But that said, as we face adversaries across the globe who will use this technology to move money around and to take action that will negatively affect the United States, I firmly believe that bringing transparency through a regulatory structure to financial markets will only be a positive step in shedding more light and giving our prosecutors, whether it's at the Justice Department or at the state level, more access to information of individuals, institutions, and the flow of this digital commodity so that we can root out fraud and bad actors and find these individuals who are trying to do harm to the United States.
Yeah. I understand the White House is working on a digital asset executive order. Have you or your staff been part of these discussions?
They have been a part of the discussions, and they've been working with the White House quite frequently over the past several months. I'm not aware of the exact timing of the issuance of a potential executive order, but to answer your question, we have been participating and working with the White House.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much. I believe we have Senator Smith with us virtually. So, Senator Smith. We shall see. Senator Smith, are you with us? Speaking of technology, digital technology. We will come back to her. And at this point, we will go to Senator Marshall.
Well, thank you, Madam Chair. This morning, I'm sitting here between an Auburn Tiger and an Arkansas Razorback. And I just wanted to congratulate both those teams and remember why we celebrate the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat, and what a great blessing it is to have college sports. So congratulations to both of those teams. A great game last night. Madam Chair, if I could, I just wanted to publicly request that we get Secretary Vilsack in front of us sometime. I'm certainly concerned. I think we have some questions that America want to ask him about. Back home, the price of fertilizer is certainly an issue. And we'd like to ask Secretary Vilsack's opinion on that, and how is that going to impact the SNAP budget? The 30 by 30 program certainly has farmers back home alarmed, so we'd love to have him in front of us sometime.
Happy to offer an invitation, Senator Bozeman, and I will work on that.
Thank you so much. Chairman, welcome back to the committee as well. As I've been allowed to travel and meet some folks in foreign countries and leadership and visit our embassies, every one of those visits at some point in time talks about their concerns about cryptocurrencies, specifically how it's being used in human trafficking and drug running as well. So that's the bad news. The good news is we've been meeting with companies like Coinbase, who are purchasing CFTC-regulated exchanges to voluntarily be regulated. And a little bit of background in the banking industry, I always want to know, who is our customer? So specifically, what would the CFTC's role be in help regulate a company like Coinbase? Or, how do we ensure that we know who our customers are right now, and what does that look like going forward to you?
Thank you, Senator Marshall. You know, with respect to that particular acquisition, and that's not been the only one in the past few years, my understanding is that they will use that entity that has a CFTC license to trade derivatives. I don't know if that will evolve or change, but we do have a number of onboarding processes and requirements in our law and the rules that we implemented off of the law to ensure that there are appropriate anti-money laundering, know your customer requirements, proper capital requirements, and that as a general matter, and these have developed over decades, as you can imagine, that individuals know your customer, both from an individual retail or institutional investor standpoint, to a broker or an FCM, to the exchanges, the clearinghouses, and the data repository. So I am confident we have a very robust system in place. We work closely with the exchanges and our SROs, most notably the National Futures Association, to ensure that we're doing our best to identify individuals who may be bad actors or participating in illicit activity.
Would you agree with me, though, if they're not in an exchange of some sort with monitoring, that they don't know who their customer is right now?
Absolutely.
Do you agree with the folks who are telling me that there's a significant concern that this is being used for human trafficking and drug smuggling?
I do agree.
And what would the CFTC's role, what would you do to put meat on the bones to make sure that we do, that we're able to control that? What could you do if you were given more authority?
Senator, I think it's literally bringing this market into the regulatory fold. And it's not unlike what I was saying earlier to Senator Tuberville about the Justice Department case yesterday. if this ecosystem exists outside of the regulatory fold, all of these steps, all of these processes that we built over decades to protect investors, protect individuals from illicit activity, are unregulated. Now, to some extent, these institutions do these things, but it's not enough. And I think we need the full power of the federal government, the rule of law, and our enforcement authority to send a message to both deter this activity, but root it out if it occurs. So I don't think it would require anything new or different than what we do with respect to our regulated entities. We just need to bring it into the regulatory fold.
Certainly my farmers and ranchers back home are not my grandparents' farm. They use CFTC markets to hedge bets, to as a risk management tool. That's the best way to describe it, a risk management tool. Do you see an opportunity for this these cryptocurrencies to offer them another risk management tool?
It depends on how the, you know, some of the coins are stores of value. You know, Bitcoin has been most notably compared to gold or as a store of value. We've seen a direct correlation between the price movements of Bitcoin and traditional assets as opposed to a safe haven asset. But I don't want to get into too many details there, but I could see in the future, depending on the development of the coins, that some of these tools could be used as a risk management tool against certain movements in currency or other commodities. But we would need a lot more time to see sort of the movement of the coins relative to other commodities or currencies to see how it might be a risk management tool.
So last question, Bitcoin smells like a commodity, it looks like a commodity, it tastes like a commodity. Is Bitcoin a commodity?
Per a Eastern District of New York Federal District Court ruling in 2018, it is a commodity.
Thank you. I yield back.
Thank you very much. I'll now turn to Senator Gillibrand, who I believe is with us virtually, and then we have Senator Hoeven, who's with us virtually, and then Senator Klobuchar is here. So, Senator Gillibrand.
Hi, Madam Chairwoman. Mr. Benham, I understand that cryptocurrency exchange markets differ from many commodity markets that the CFTC oversees, in that unlike commodity markets for grain or oil, for example, cryptocurrency exchange markets often welcome individual retail investors. I'm glad to see that these new opportunities will be open to everybody and not just institutional investors. But given this fact that many everyday Americans will become involved in this emerging financial market, I want cybersecurity to remain a priority as we promulgate regulations. Cyber attacks have become a major threat throughout the world and could result in a massive swings in valuation, lost intellectual property, or significant market disruptions through hacks or other targeted cyber attacks. How do you view the Commission's current ability to effectively oversee the marketplace and prevent cyber attacks?
Thank you, Senator. We simply don't have enough authority to oversee the cash commodity digital asset marketplace. I think both regulators and customers would benefit from a traditional market structure, one that we have implemented on the derivatives markets, and that's not dissimilar to what we see on the security side. But more importantly, the marketplace, the institutions, the technologists would benefit from it too. So I do think customers would benefit greatly, as I've said before. Transparency would be brought into the marketplace, and individuals who wanted to allocate capital towards digital assets would benefit from the security, the safety, and the comfort of knowing that these are regulated markets with the rule of law and enforcement authority behind it, so that if there are bad actors, which there always are, those individuals or institutions will be held accountable for their actions. In terms of
I hear you saying that you don't have the authority to do this. If you did have the authority, can you elaborate on whether CFTC has the ability to manage and guard proprietary information? And what steps, if any, can we in government take to prevent cyber attacks in this sector of the economy if you did have the authority?
Senator, it's no different than what we do right now with respect to derivatives markets. We take private information and confidential information very carefully. We handle it very carefully, but it is a critical element of our surveillance tools as we overlook a very broad market. And we interact with market participants and registrants regularly to ensure that the steps we're taking to protect information, whether it's PII or data or market information, is held confidential and is held in a safe place. I do think that this technology poses new challenges and new risks. given the nature of it vis-a-vis traditional markets. But these would be questions that I would certainly welcome the opportunity to talk to you about so that we could see a reduction, hopefully, in these cyber attacks and thefts, which unfortunately happen all too often. But we need to bring this technology and this market into a regulatory fold at a minimum to start reducing some of these risks that exist, and then take progressive steps forward to ensure that we're, if not ahead of the game, at least moving with the marketplace, which, as you know, moves very quickly.
Yes, and I appreciate your answers, but you aren't answering the fundamental question of whether you have the ability to guard proprietary information and deal with cyber attacks in this sector, given the differences between your current regulatory framework. So it's a very specific question. Do you have the ability and the competency to manage the market for proprietary information, but also prevent cyber attacks in the sector? And if your answer is you don't know, that's fine. I just want to know, do you have the technical expertise and ability to guard cyber markets? I sit on the Intelligence Committee and the Armed Services Committee. Being able to subvert and prevent cyber attacks is difficult for every industry. But as you are critical infrastructure, I'm really pushing down on, do you have the technical capability to do this if we give you the authority?
The answer is no, we don't have it, because this is
that not- is what I wanted to know. Thank you. Okay. Given how resource intensive the cryptocurrency mining process is, I'm particularly interested in promulgating regulations that are consistent with our goals to stem climate change. There is a company in my home state that recently reopened a power plant. That plant used to meet demand surges, but this company has connected it to a natural gas pipeline and is planning to greatly expand its historical operating capacity, using it to generate electricity for their cryptocurrency mining operation. How can we make sure that the correct incentives or regulations are in place so that we can simultaneously support the growth of this new technology without sacrificing the important work we are doing to stem climate change?
So as I mentioned in my statement, I've asked the Climate Risk Unit, which is a group of staff that I formed last year, to look into this issue and see if we can come up with policy directives or ideas for you to consider, as well as the agency. I've also asked staff within Lab CFTC, which has been our sort of innovative hub for the past few years, to think about this issue. We've been engaging with stakeholders and asking them to bring us ideas. My gut reaction, without having a conclusive set of ideas to you, but I look forward to bringing those to you, is that something that has served markets well are disclosures. Disclosures in both the derivatives markets and securities markets and all other financial markets. If we can continue to raise awareness about this very staggering issue and let end users and consumers know what is happening and the disproportionate demand and need for energy as it relates to mining Bitcoin or other coins, those bits of information, that type of information, that disclosure will hopefully create incentives to move market participants and stakeholders away from that method of mining and towards either renewable energy sources and, most importantly, away from carbon-intensive energy sources.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Madam Chairwoman.
Thank you very much. Senator Hovind, I believe, is with us digitally.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. And Chairman Benham, would you characterize cryptocurrency as a commodity, a currency, or a security, and why?
Senator, there are thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of digital assets and cryptocurrencies, so I wouldn't want to identify them collectively. There are certainly a large number of coins that are commodities, including two of the biggest, which are Bitcoin and Ether. But given the vast number, there's no doubt in my mind there are also security coins. This is a big, big issue, and one that I think we collectively should work on as we think about a regulatory environment, if at all, is to draw very clear, distinct rules of the road of what might constitute a commodity versus what might constitute a security.
So should there be a lead agency for regulating cryptocurrency?
I don't think this will be any, from a markets perspective, I don't think this issue that we're facing is much different than what the CFTC and most notably the SEC have faced for the past 40 to 50 years. There are futures that are regulated by the SEC, a bulk obviously being regulated by the CFTC. The swaps market, which this committee knows well, when Dodd-Frank was passed, we had to create a line between traditional swaps and security-based swaps. We have a great relationship. I don't think this is any different. Would require a lot of hard thinking, novel questions, legal implications, but I certainly think we could end up in a place where both regulators, both agencies have jurisdiction over cash markets, us, the CFTC, having it over commodities, the SEC having jurisdiction over securities.
So CFTC, SEC, Treasury should all be regulating cryptocurrency in different ways as they do in other financial markets.
Well, so from a markets perspective, the only market regulators we have within the federal government are the Commodity Futures Trading Commission and the Securities and Exchange Commission. So I would very clearly say those would be the only two market regulators over digital asset markets. But naturally, given the vast number of issues, whether it's illicit activity, national security issues, trade, and any number of issues that will emerge if this technology continues to take root, will require an all-hands-on-deck effort by the government because it implicates expertise from different agencies.
What should Congress be doing right now in terms of legislation to help make sure that the right regulatory oversight structure is in place as this industry develops?
Senator, given our limited authority, which I've mentioned before, is very narrow to fraud and manipulation in cash markets, my recommendation to you and your colleagues is that we need authorization and a regulatory structure over cash digital assets. That will not be structurally much different than the current markets that we oversee. There will obviously, like I said earlier, be novel issues and questions we have to ask around custody and settlement, given the digital nature of these assets. But in terms of general market structure, we need to embed core principles like pre-trade transparency, centralized and concentrated order books, post-trade transparency, and clear, consistent rules around custody, settlement, clearing, and other elements of the trading process.
Given the newness and the complexity of cryptocurrency, is there an understanding in terms of how that should be done and what it should entail?
I think there's a general understanding, and this goes to my previous answer is, and I say this with a bit of caution, but markets are markets. And what we've observed to the extent that we can is that these assets, regardless of the fact that they're so unique from traditional derivatives or securities, they function and trade just like any other asset would on a marketplace. So I do think the decades of experience we have within the United States going back well over 100 years will inform us nicely in terms of what market structure we need to start with, in terms of what the framework would look like. However, time will pressure us to force all of us collectively to ask very difficult questions and novel questions about the technology, about the traceability, about the sourcing that will go most notably to custody issues, but also what exactly are we identifying as a reportable transaction? What information do we need? And ensuring that it's similar and consistent globally above all else. But these are questions that you're welcome to ask and discuss with you.
And I don't mind out of time here, but and you think that this is going to continue to grow and be a very pervasive source of executing financial transactions?
Senator, I'd be hard-pressed to say no to that question. I'm very cautious in what I say about what the future may hold, but as the chairman of the CFTC, I do think my responsibility is to assume that it will continue to take root and that this technology will continue to emerge and wind itself into traditional finance. If we don't approach the technology that way, we run the risk of stability and safety and soundness issues even in a few years, let alone 10 or 20 or 30 years. So I think we have to work under the assumption that it will, it could, and it will. And whether or not it does, whether it's parts or the whole sort of concept of digital assets is irrelevant. I think the important thing is to focus on the assumption that it does and start to build the building blocks of a regulatory structure now so that we don't run into continued problems and risks, whether it's cyber, theft, illicit activity, or financial stability risks in the future.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Senator
Thank
Hoban.
You, Chair. Thank you.
Senator Klobuchar.
Well, thank you very much, Chairman Stabenow. Thank you, Senator Bozeman, for having this important hearing. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know what they say in the Senate, everyone said it, but I haven't. So I'm going to ask you a few follow-up questions that I heard my colleagues, and I appreciate your answers. As you noted, there is no one regulator at either the state or the federal level with sufficient visibility and authority into digital asset trading to fully go after some of the conflicts or deceptive trade practices impacting retail customers. Can you speak to the existing gaps between the CFTC and the SEC in the regulation? And do you have recommendations how to bridge that? I know you just gave some recs to Senator Hoban, but that particular issue. And do you think, the final thing is gaps, recs, and do you think the CFTC is well suited to assume a larger role over spot markets for digital assets? And what authorities do you need to do it?
Thanks, Senator Klobuchar. In terms of gaps, the most noticeable gap is clarity around what constitutes security and what constitutes a commodity. I think the Securities Exchange Commission has more authority than we do, certainly in terms of cash market regulation. But the question in terms of defining what and which of these digital assets are securities becomes the hardest question for both the agency and also market participants. For us, the bigger challenge, obviously, in addition to finding out what and which coins constitute commodities, is this cash market regulation, which segues nicely into your second question. We are a derivatives market regulator. We do not regulate cash markets. We would need more congressional authority to regulate cash markets. I firmly believe we are well suited to do this. We have a long history of looking into, examining, and working with the digital asset marketplace. And at its core, we are a market regulator. And as I've said several times this morning, the core principles of a market are similar across all assets, and we are well suited. We have great expertise. We would certainly build up expertise to the extent we needed in certain places, referencing Senator Gillibrand's question. But I do think we're well suited to do it, and we're prepared as well.
Are there parallels between how Dodd-Frank established a split regime for swap instruments and the need for regulation of digital assets today?
Absolutely. And it's a perfect example and a perfect analogy because this was, you know, a point of friction, you know, 12, 15 years ago. But we figured it out, and Congress helped us figure it out. You gave us clear directives, and the two agencies did that over a number of years. And I could say pretty confidently that the market is well functioning, and each of the agencies have relative jurisdiction over over different types of swaps, and we can do the same thing here.
Mm-hmm. We know, and I know we've been discussions about this. We've seen exponential growth. Rising from a market capitalization in cryptocurrency from $1.6 billion in 2013 to nearly $2 trillion today. And the popularity of these assets has been attributed to their ability to diversify investment portfolios. We know all the hedge against risk. But with the growing popularity, as I mentioned, of spot market trading, how does the CFTC go about disseminating information to the general public about scams and things and getting it out there, because this is a brand new frontier for many people. And that's my past experience as a prosecutor. I know when there's brand new frontiers, the scammers are there.
They are, and we're seeing the traditional methods used, whether it's Ponzi schemes, pump and dumps. I'll note that we even put out a notice earlier this week or late last week about dating apps and scams happening through dating apps. It is no different than what we've seen. They're just using this new asset class as a tool to prey on vulnerable individuals. We're using our Office of Consumer Education to do as much as we can with what we have to let the public know about the risks associated both with the assets but also with the scams that are happening. And, you know, as you would know as well as anyone, we have to rely on tips and whistleblowers to bring some of these fraud and manipulation cases, which is extremely helpful, but it is so limited. And I fear that there is a well of fraud and manipulation happening and individuals losing money that we are just not aware of because this market is very opaque.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. I believe we have Senator Booker with us virtually. Senator Booker.
Yes, you have me. Thank you very much.
Yes.
This is a really exciting hearing. I want to thank our chairwoman for hosting it. I actually believe there's some urgency that we act in this space. I think that we can create a more sensible regulatory framework. I've always been concerned about, with technology moving, the lack of government's ability to move at the speed of technology undermines the ability for Americans to apply this technology. I came into the Senate on the Commerce Committee, and I remember the FAA was regulating drones in such a horrible way that other countries like France were using drones for dangerous missions, from fixing poles and wires to doing mining work, where we in the United States were still seeing death rates that could have been avoided with technology, but the FAA was so over-regulating this new technology. And I said to the then chairperson of the FAA that if you were around during the time of Orville and Wilbur Wright, we would have never gotten off the ground. And so this is one of those cases where we are already seeing some of the hopeful, optimistic possibilities in cryptocurrency. It has a democratizing a force. Minorities are overrepresented in using that, and obviously it represent with traditional banking are underbanked traditionally. And so for me, this disintermediation possibilities, the democratizing possibilities offer a lot of hope, but I do think this committee has a bit of some urgency to act in this space and create some frameworks and guardrails to protect against the things some of my colleagues have already brought up, like fraud. And so I'd like to ask the chairman right away, what makes you hopeful and optimistic in this space, one, and then two, can you state quite clearly, because I believe you are, this agency is, why is this the best agency to provide that needed framework and the right regulation to allow this space to potentially thrive and achieve that vision that you might have about the possibilities of this area?
Thank you, Senator Booker. Answering your first question about my optimism or the what the technology holds, I don't view this any differently than the series of milestones we've seen over the past 100 years in terms of technological development. And this is creating a potential avenue for quicker, better, more efficient access to capital and the transfer of value between individuals at a peer-to-peer level. We have to be very careful and cautious and deliberative as we approach this technology, as you pointed out, both from a regulatory standpoint, but I think from a market standpoint. There are shifts in terms of market structure and how folks access capital and how they transfer capital that disintermediate the guardrails that have been built up over decades to protect customers, whether it's AML, money laundering, or know your customer, and other very, very beneficial attributes of our financial system and the guardrails that have been built up over time. So I think this is naturally just the next step. It provides a lot of opportunity for our country to take a leading role, but we have to be deliberate and cautious as we approach it and be patient so that we do it right and that we don't have any unintended consequences. Regarding your second question, you know, I'll just lean on the fact twofold is one, we are a market regulator. We've been doing this for many, many years. And regardless of the fact that we oversee derivatives assets, we know market structure. We know surveillance. We know enforcement. We know the core components and foundations and pillars of what makes markets work, what makes markets transparent, and most importantly, what protects customer money. And we will continue to use that as the foundation to push forward on a potential marketplace, a regulated marketplace for this technology. The second element of that question or response to your question is we have been uniquely exposed to digital assets for over 5 or 6 years, which doesn't seem like a lot of time, but relative to other agencies is actually quite long. And it is because of our role as a commodity regulator, because of the emergence of regulated futures products that reference digital assets. It's the creation of our lab CFTC many years ago. And then as Senator Marshall mentioned earlier, it's what we're seeing in the marketplace and incumbent digital asset companies starting to purchase traditional CFTC entities or licensed entities. So I think we are well positioned. We have a lot of experience. We have great enforcement lawyers, surveillance attorneys, market intelligence experts. And I think we are a few steps ahead and ready to run with this if that's what this committee and Congress desires.
Well, I appreciate those sage and wise words from another bald New Jerseyan. I do just want to say thank you again to the chairwoman. I do believe we really need to move quickly to control for some of the worries that we have, but also to seize upon a regulatory framework that will help this. As I said earlier, if you just look at the demographics, it's already having a bit of a leveling field. This is a area where 16% of all Americans are involved in crypto, and that's growing. But already you see 18% of African Americans, 20% of Latinos. You see the majority of crypto owners don't have college degrees, and they're engaging in this space. I just think this is a time for us to act quickly. And I'm excited to do that in a bipartisan way through this committee that I believe has real jurisdiction in this space. Thank you, Chairwoman.
Well, thank you, Senator Booker. And we do have a real bipartisan opportunity to do something I think is important and urgent at this time. So thanks very much. I'm going to say thank you, Chairman Benham. And I know we have other members that will be submitting questions to you in writing as usual. There are multiple hearings going on today at the same time, but much interest in working with you and getting your thoughts on an area that needs a lot of thoughtfulness and careful discussion about how to move forward. So thank you very much. Look forward to working with you. I'm going to call forward our next panel. We have four witnesses who we are anxious to hear from. And I am going to also just indicate that, as usual, we are going to be running up against some votes that are scheduled to start at 11:30, two votes. We'll just be flexible here on how we move forward. But as you come to sit down, I'm going to begin introductions in the interest of time. So I want to welcome the four members of our second panel. All four of you are leaders and educators in the digital asset marketplace. And we look forward to hearing from you about this market, including the current regulatory landscape, as we consider what the future might look like, should look like. First of all, Ms. Sandra Rowe, CEO of the Global Blockchain Business Council. With her experience in investment banking, currency markets, and digital assets, Ms. Rowe is a frequent university guest lecturer and educates lawmakers, businesses, and the media on blockchain technology. Ms. Rowe is an appointee to the New York State Digital Currency Task Force and serves on various international advisory councils, including the World Economic Forum's Digital Currencies Governance Consortium. While at the CME Group, she led the exchange's work on developing a Bitcoin futures contract and filed CME's first crypto derivatives patents. Second, Mr. Sam Bankman-Fried is the co-founder and CEO of FTX, one of the world's largest digital asset trading platforms. He co-founded the company in 2019 and formed FTX US in 2020 to service US customers. Its affiliate, FTX US Derivatives, is one of the first crypto-based exchanges to be registered with the CFTC to offer digital asset derivatives. Prior to his involvement in the digital asset space, Mr. Bankman-Fried was a quantitative trader at Jane Street Capital. Mr. Kevin Werbach is a professor of the Wharton School and the director of the Wharton Blockchain and Digital Asset Project. He is the author of a book titled The Blockchain and the New Architecture of Trust. As an educator, he focuses on the business, legal, and public policy implications of emerging technologies, including digital assets. Mr. Werbach participated in the development of technology policy initiatives as part of the Obama administration's presidential transition team. And he served as counsel for new technology policy at the Federal Communications Commission. And now I'm going to turn to Ranking Member Bozeman for our fourth witness introduction.
Thank you, Madam Chair. It's a pleasure to introduce Ms. Perianne Boring. Ms. Boring is the founder and chief executive officer of the Chamber of Digital Commerce, the world's largest trade association representing the blockchain industry. The Chamber's mission is to promote the acceptance and use of digital assets and blockchain-based technologies, working with policymakers, regulatory agencies, and the industry. The Chamber advocates for a pro-growth environment that fosters job creation, innovation, and investment. Perianne was named one of America's top 50 women in tech by Forbes and one of the 10 most influential people in blockchain by CoinDesk. She appears regularly in the financial media to share insights on digital asset and blockchain innovations and is an active participant in public policy discussions. Prior to forming the Chamber, Perianne served as a television anchor for an international finance program that ran in more than 100 countries and reached over 650 million viewers. She began her career as a legislative analyst in the U.S. House of Representatives, advising on finance, economics, tax, and healthcare policy. Thank you again for joining us today.
Well, thank you again to each of you. You clearly have tremendous amount of experience and knowledge in this space. And so we will ask each of you to give 5 minutes of opening testimony, and then we will go to questions, and we'll start with Ms. Rowe.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair Stabenow, Ranking Member Bozeman, and members of the committee. Thank you for inviting me to testify. My name is Sandra Rowe, and I am the CEO of the Global Blockchain Business Council, the leading not-for-profit industry association for blockchain technology ecosystem, representing nearly 400 institutional members. I began my career as a financial engineer at Deutsche Bank and Morgan Stanley. Subsequently, I led CME Group's digitization team, where we pioneered some of the earliest regulated cryptocurrency products. And for example, the CME Bitcoin futures today on which US Bitcoin ETFs trade. At CME, my team worked together closely with the CFTC. And these close relationships were critical to our ability to innovate effectively and responsibly. Today, I will share three blockchain use cases that are moving our society in a more secure, transparent, and equitable direction. But first, as requested by the committee, I will start with some basics. The Bitcoin white paper, published in 2008, outlined a peer-to-peer electronic cash system using a consensus mechanism known as proof of work. On the Bitcoin ledger, transactions are arranged in consecutive blocks. Simply put, proof of work requires members of a network, known as miners, to solve a mathematical puzzle to secure the network. Once a miner solves and confirms a transaction, it is assigned to a block. The block is timestamped and added linearly to the blockchain. For this work, the miner that first solved the puzzle receives compensation in the form of a block reward. Since Bitcoin's creation, a variety of other consensus mechanisms have been created. Most popular among them, something called proof of stake. Proof of stake is a consensus mechanism where users often offer their digital assets as collateral for a chance to validate a transaction. It is estimated that the energy required to participate in a proof-of-stake network is roughly equivalent to the energy required to operate a home computer. Each consensus mechanism has benefits and drawbacks. Regardless of the consensus mechanism, most blockchains share the following attributes. Blockchains help us move data as value in a secure, lower-cost, peer-to-peer model. Blockchains necessitate collaboration. Blockchains facilitate permanence of records, which makes cooking the books or tampering with records extremely difficult. Finally, blockchain transactions are traceable. Most ledgers are pseudonymous, making it possible to track the flow of funds. So what does this look like in practice? The First National Bank of Omaha is working with a consortium of partners to create Cattle ID, a system that uses blockchain to create unique digital identifiers for cattle and enables cattle ranchers to add health and treatment records to each animal. Another company, Circular, is tokenizing critical minerals and metals to track their journey from mine to factory to recycling. These materials are essential to the technology and automotive industries. Enhanced tracking and tracing of these materials can increase accountability and reduce the exploitation of people and planet. Finally, the InterWork Alliance, Microsoft, and others are working to create transparent and functional voluntary carbon credit markets. By creating common standards, they are helping markets reduce fraud, improve discovery, and create more accurate calculations of carbon offsets and credits. Harnessing this technology to solve real-world problems and expand economic opportunities will be a generational effort. It is not too late for the U.S. to lead. I look forward to answering your questions today.
Thank you very much. And next, Sam Bankman-Fried. Welcome.
Thank you, Chair Stabenow, Ranking Member Bozeman, and members of the committee. Thanks so much for having me here today. I'm Sam Bankman-Fried, the CEO and co-founder of FTX. We are a global digital asset exchange. We were founded in 2019, and today we have roughly $15 billion of volume that trade daily on the platform. One of the big things that I want to point to in the digital asset industry is the equitable access that it provides to users, which is somewhat unique to this industry. Traditionally, in order to get access to market data, you need to pay millions or tens of millions of dollars per year, often separately to each venue, such that only the largest and most sophisticated trading firms are even allowed to see the order book that they are sending their orders to. Intermediaries obscure the data, obscure the transparency. In the cryptocurrency industry and on FTX in particular, all of our market data is 100% free for everyone. It is available on our website for users, for regulators, for press, and any other interested parties. We don't charge licensing fees. We don't charge registration fees. We don't charge data fees. It's all available for free. In addition to that, in traditional market structures, most consumers do not have the same access to liquidity that the most sophisticated investors do. While the largest trading firms can go straight to an exchange, sending orders directly into the best price matching engine, most consumers are forced to go through many different intermediaries, each of which add latency, increase fees, reduce transparency, reduce the flexibility of the orders that they can send, and results in a very different market structure and a less favorable market structure that the less sophisticated members are allowed to access. On FTX and in general the digital asset ecosystem, everyone who is registered is allowed to send orders directly to our exchange in the same way. Whether you're doing it through our mobile app, our website, or our API, they all have the same access directly to our matching engine, and every user, from the consumer to the sophisticated trading firm, gets equitable access to our liquidity. Talking a little bit about what our U.S. business looks like today, we have a spot or cash market that offers digital asset commodity transactions, for instance, a Bitcoin versus U.S. dollar spot marketplace. We also have a CFTC-licensed digital asset derivatives exchange, formerly LedgerX, now FTX US Derivatives, which has numerous licenses from the CFTC to offer futures and options on digital assets and follows the same general model as the rest of our systems do with equitable access and free market data. The spot business, as has been mentioned here earlier today, is not chiefly overseen by a federal markets regulator, although the CFTC does have some amount of anti-fraud investigative authority, was instead overseen by a patchwork of state money transmitter and money service business organizations. Looking at the regulatory landscape today for digital assets, there are some holes. And one that I want to point to in particular, which has been brought up earlier today, is around spot commodity transactions. With commodity futures, the CFTC unambiguously has regulatory oversight and authority. With securities markets, the SEC clearly has authority. With cash commodity markets, it is substantially less clear. And those are the markets that spot Bitcoins trade on today in the United States without a clear federal regulator. This leads to all the standard risks with having not enough federal oversight, risk to consumers, potential systemic risks, and a lack of clarity for the industry. This has led to the state we're in today, where despite the majority of the intellectual property for the digital asset industry originating from the United States, 95% of volume occurs offshore. The majority of assets are not accessible at all from the United States. It would be great to be able to move that liquidity, that business, back onshore, and providing federal oversight and clarity would be great for that. I think that the CFTC is in a very strong position to do this. The CFTC has extensive experience regulating digital asset markets through their cryptocurrency futures markets that they list. They have extensive markets regulatory activity. They understand the cash markets, and they have extensive experience monitoring the cybersecurity of their registrants. We and other registrants go through very extensive protocols by them to ensure the safeguarding of assets. I would love to see that jurisdiction expand to be able to provide federal oversight for the cash markets, similar to how they do for derivatives markets today, both to provide consumer protection, protecting systemic risks, and to provide a clear and consistent framework for the industry to be able to bring much of this back onshore. Thanks, and I'm excited to answer any questions that you guys have for me today.
Thank you very much. Ms. Boring, welcome.
Thank you for inviting me to participate in today's hearing. I first learned about Bitcoin right here when I was working as a congressional staffer in 2011. After seeing the financial crisis of 08 rock my community, I left my home state of Florida to work on public policy for a more sound and inclusive financial and monetary system. I am convinced that this technology is our best hope for achieving that. Bitcoin, other digital assets, and blockchain technology represents American values like democratization at its core. Its distributed nature should be embraced, not feared. These technologies will play a key role in the financial services industry and will soon be considered critical infrastructure as we move towards a digital economy. Many nations around the world understand this, and they are competing to be leaders of exponential technologies like blockchain. As we look across the global stage, we see many nations, most notably the Communist Party of China, who have made blockchain technology a top national priority. We find ourselves in a new space race. It is the cyberspace race of controlling the systems and the governance that will power the digital economy. And I fear that we are so far behind that we haven't even acknowledged that there's a race underway. As the world's largest economy, the stakes cannot be higher. With that said, our nation has experienced these challenges before, whether it was the space race or internet innovation, and our experiences show us that we do best when we recognize the private sector is our greatest strength. As the first and the largest blockchain policy organization, we have over 8 years of experience in understanding the nuances and the complexities of digital asset policy frameworks. It is from this position that I urge the committee to consider two key issues: regulatory clarity and regulatory cohesion. Digital asset innovators have been operating in an unclear regulatory environment for far too long. In order for American businesses to be able to compete on the global stage, they need to know what the rules of the road are. Today, our regulatory structure is fragmented. There's regulators that police fraud and market integrity, such as the CFTC and the SEC. There's consumer protection regulators, including the CFPB and the FTC. There's prudential and monetary bank policy regulators, such as the Fed, the OCC, and the FDIC. There's another category of regulators that consist of financial policy and anti-crime orgs, including FinCEN and the Department of Justice. And then on top of all of this, there's a number of state-level regulators that have a purview over digital assets as well. This fragmentation has led to a lack of regulatory clarity and is hampering innovation and impacting American global competitiveness. We have members who have been waiting for action by the regulators for over 5 years, only to take their products elsewhere. It's time for the U.S. and for this committee to begin putting in place policies that create clarity and spur innovation and blockchain and economic growth and opportunity for all. We urge this committee to work with other policymakers to first adopt the Chamber's 2019 National Action Plan for Blockchain, which proposes that U.S. blockchain policy should take a holistic government approach with clearly articulated support for the private sector development of innovation required to grow emerging industries. And second, provide regulatory clarity by identifying a lead regulator. We believe the CFTC is well positioned to assume that role. The CFTC is a market regulator that has a long history of taking on the regulation of new and innovative products, with a strong track record of enforcing cases of fraud, market manipulation, and other illegal activity. The CFTC already regulates Bitcoin and Ether, which accounts for about 60% of the market today. It has spot market anti-fraud and manipulation enforcement authority, and it has a history of vetting and approving new types of innovative products, and most recently, digital assets. And finally, the CFTC's principles-based regime has a mandate to promote responsible innovation. A principles-based model is effective in the regulation of new asset classes because it allows the regulator to set desired outcomes, but gives the market the flexibility to innovate on how those outcomes are achieved. I am confident a similar policy framework will achieve the same results for blockchain and for our country. Thank you. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much. And last but certainly not least, Mr. Werbach.
Chair Stabenow, Ranking Member Bozeman, members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to testify before you. I'll discuss four issues which are addressed at greater length in my written statement. First, what are digital assets? Second, how should we think about regulating them? Third, what are some of the major risks? And fourth, what can we learn from the development of internet regulation? Digital assets have the potential to increase efficiency, improve equity, promote privacy and individual freedoms, and broadly create more competitive, fair, and transparent markets. I emphasize, though, the word potential. The vision of a decentralized Web3 replacing centralized platforms is a beautiful dream that many are passionately working toward. But we must separate dreams from present reality. While the technical foundations are complex and important, the basic concepts here are straightforward. Most people don't understand how the internet actually works either. Digital assets are simply things of value represented through digital tokens used in valid transactions on a blockchain ledger. Blockchain diffuses the trust that previously resided in central entities. However, this doesn't mean trust goes away. Having confidence that a digital representation on a public shared ledger is actually worth something, potentially millions of dollars in the cases of certain non-fungible tokens, is fundamentally an exercise in trust. Moreover, the absence of centralized trust creates burdens as well. If you lose the cryptographic keys associated with your digital assets, they're effectively gone. Platforms such as Coinbase and FTX generally take custody of users' assets, similar to traditional exchanges, because there are efficiencies of central intermediation. Decentralized finance, or DeFi, which removes these custodial relationships, raises its own challenges. We must examine carefully where risks and opportunities for abuses arise. Too much of the conversation around digital assets starts with the mistaken assumption they're currently unregulated. Just because something is a new kind of derivative or security doesn't mean those frameworks no longer apply. Addressing digital assets won't be the task for any one regulator, any more than internet policy is. The CFTC should be given authority where the market activity involved is something it's well suited to address. Even more important, the divide between agencies shouldn't be a reason for gaps in the regulatory regime. Someone needs clear authority over spot markets in digital assets that are not considered securities, over exchanges that are now among the most valuable and prominent firms in financial services, including some that are nominally offshore, and stablecoins that claim reserves in the tens of billions. And the only way over the long run to promote trust in legitimate firms is to distinguish and take down the bad actors. According to Chainalysis, cryptocurrency crime reached an all-time high in 2021, with $14 billion sent to known illicit addresses. It's worth noting this represented only 0.15% of transaction volume. However, $14 billion is not a small number. And hacks draining tens or hundreds of millions of dollars, such as the recent wormhole attack, are distressingly common. Moreover, practices that are routinely banned for other asset classes, such as wash trading, pump and dump schemes, fake assets, and hidden conflicts, such as exchanges listing tokens they previously invested in, are widespread. And the stablecoin Tether continues to play an outsized role in the digital asset world, despite having been found to have lied about its backing and engaged in other illegitimate practices. There's something wrong when sizable attacks and fraud are so common, yet investors and major firms appear to shrug them off entirely. Failing to lose trust in untrustworthy platforms suggests investors may not rationally be assessing risks. That could be a recipe for disaster. I helped develop the U.S. approach to internet regulation in the 1990s in the Clinton administration. The policy then was to avoid unnecessary restrictions on innovation while critically addressing the policy issues that arose. Most internet activity then did not involve regulated activities. When it did, such as communication services under the jurisdiction of the FCC, regulators took action to avoid situations where quirks in technology would undermine legitimate public policy goals. Many times I've heard that regulatory hurdles on digital assets would cause the U.S. to fall behind. Yet here we are, 2022, the U.S. is home to a large, diverse, and growing industry of digital asset and blockchain firms and investors. Thanks to the dynamism of our economy, and also to the trust in our markets. That said, the sooner the gaps in legal authority or ill-fitting rules can be addressed, the better. This is already a $2 trillion market. This committee should ensure the CFTC has the legal authority and resources to engage in active fact-finding, rulemaking, and enforcement in the digital asset space in concert with other regulators at the federal and state level. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much. We appreciate the testimony of all of you. And let me start with questions and ask Mr. Bankman-Fried, you have supported increased regulation for the spot digital asset market. And one of the concerns that I have is that without additional resources, this will put the CFTC in a situation where they're being pulled away from its traditional areas of responsibility, regulating the derivatives markets, including the markets critical for our agricultural producers. So I wonder if you might speak to how Congress should ensure that the CFTC has adequate resources to continue to oversee the markets at its core of its jurisdictions while expanding their responsibilities.
Thank you, Chair Stabenow. I completely agree. I would love to see the CFTC play a more active role in licensing and regulating the digital asset space, and I agree that that will likely involve increasing its scope and an increased need for resources. There are, of course, a lot of ways to address that. You can imagine addressing it through appropriations, through other means. I think one way could be contributions from the digital asset industry as well. If that were the preferred approach, I know that we would be completely comfortable participating in that so long as it was a reasonable framework. Obviously, we don't want it to be a blank check of infinite size, but assume that it is a well thought out and reasonable framework for supporting the licensing activity of the CFTC in the digital asset ecosystem. I think that would be healthy, and I think we would be happy to play a part, and I suspect that other members of the digital asset industry would as well.
All right, thank you very much. I think this is going to be important, and certainly as in other areas and financial entities and so on, where there are fees and something that where folks are contributing. And so I think that's going to be important to be able to give the CFTC the additional resources to do what you and others are suggesting. So I appreciate that. Ms. Rowe, Bitcoin mining is, as we've talked about, is extremely energy intensive. The United States is now home to one-third of the world's Bitcoin mining, much of which is powered by fossil fuels. I'm concerned this is going to threat our ability to combat the existential threat of climate change and strain our electrical grid. So can mining become more sustainable? And if so, what can Congress do to encourage this transition?
Absolutely. Thank you very much for that question, Chair Stabenow. Firstly, if we go back 5-6 years, we had a different challenge in the crypto mining sector. Most of crypto mining occurred in places like China and Russia, where we had very little visibility around what was going on in the mining sector, and often also not good energy sources or dirty energy sources. What we have today is actually an opportunity. Most of the mining has shifted to the US, to Canada, and to the Nordic countries. Why? Because people will go where they can find energy at the cheapest level possible. And when you think about the bans that have occurred in China and in Russia and various other places, that's actually a net positive, especially for the US. What we should do is to encourage the crypto mining firms to set up in an observed and obviously over having proper oversight environment where we champion the move towards increasing renewable usage. But we bring this industry to the US and to Canada and to other peers. Why? Because we need that oversight and that visibility of what is going on in such an incredibly important sector. So I encourage, there are a few things that are going on right now that policy can accelerate. Private sector is already looking to adopt more renewables. Private sector is also agreeing with states on caps. So meaning, if there is a peak load occurring in any given state, that mines shut down, they no longer mine, and they wait until the peak load has come down. These are creative and very sensible, practical ways of then transitioning to a place where we are mostly renewable. So I really encourage a rethink around how we embrace this sector and encourage the positive use of renewable energy.
Thank you very much. And Ms. Boring, what's the Chamber's view of this issue?
So first and foremost, all industries and all technologies use energy. We have very good visibility into the energy uses of Bitcoin. Today, Bitcoin mining consumes about 0.12% of the world's energy production. So if this went away, we would still have very significant conversations and issues to work out as it relates to climate change and energy usage. Two differences between Bitcoin mining and other energy producers are, one, we have very strong visibility into the energy and the cost and the resources based on the transparency of the blockchain. And second, this energy, the sector of Bitcoin mining is leading the transition to renewable energy sources. Today, the industry is powered 59% by renewable sources. It's one of the most sustainable, if not the most sustainable, industries in the world today.
Thank you very much. I see my time is up. Senator Bozeman has gone to vote as we're taking turns back and forth here. So I'm going to turn to Senator Sherrod Brown, who has multiple hats, including chairing the Banking, Housing, and Urban Affairs Committee. So welcome.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I really appreciate your question about the environment and saying that, well, we don't do it in China anymore. That's what makes us environmentally principled and conscious is does not really take us where we need to. But thanks for raising the issue, Madam Chair. We hear a lot about innovation. I'm concerned that digital assets create big risks for consumers, and in our committee, Banking Housing Committee, we've been looking at cryptocurrency for years. We're going to continue to make sure consumers are protected in these markets. Next week, the Undersecretary of the Treasury, Lang, will testify about the recent President's Working Group report on stablecoin. I look forward to coordinating with Chair Stabenow, and Senator Booker is very interested in this, and a number of others. And Senator Smith and Senator Warnock sit on both committees, so we have work to do there. I have a question to Mr. Warbach and then a question to Mr. Bankman-Fried. Mr. Warbach, digital assets make it easier to conduct transactions outside the regulations that keep criminals and terrorists from using our financial system. Yesterday, the Justice Department announced an investigation into two individuals that allegedly tried to launder more than $3 billion of stolen Bitcoin. Big risk here. How do we approach bringing digital assets within a BSA, AML, anti-money laundering framework?
Thank you, Senator. It's a very important question. There are all sorts of illicit activities that happen using digital assets, and there's a need to bring this whole ecosystem within the frameworks that we've established for illicit finance and to figure out new technological means to do that. Much of this involves finding mechanisms for entities to know their customers and to communicate that information and to provide surveillance capabilities for regulators. Now, the exact way that this happens may be different for digital assets, but in recent years, there's been movement in this direction. The Financial Action Task Force globally has adopted something called the travel rule for communicating information between virtual asset exchanges. And industry has started to work on coming up with the technological means to implement that in a way that's not inconsistent with regulation. But ultimately, it comes back to the fundamental issue that regulators need to have oversight. These need to be exchanges that are, and other entities that are subject to market regulators like the CFTC and the SEC that can figure out how to implement those kinds of requirements, because there's no question there is far too much financial crime going on. There's financial crime outside of crypto, of course, as well, but there's far too much going on using these assets.
Thank you, Professor. Mr. Bankman-Fried, if we turn on the TV these days, there are ads for crypto everywhere. I understand this Sunday, FTX will have an ad on the Super Bowl. I heard they are not cheap. There's no question that crypto companies want working people to put money on the line. That's who you're reaching out to. Last week, hackers stole $320 million from the crypto platform Wormhole. In this case, investors got lucky. The trading firm behind it came to the rescue. But we know we can't always count on those trading firms. There just isn't that much money. Crypto.com, that's the one we see if you watch college football. You see Matt Damon on just about every college football broadcast. Crypto.com lost $30 million last month. Scams and hacks are everywhere in crypto. So, Mr. Bankman-Fried, is it reckless for crypto companies to get rich by selling Americans such a dangerous, risky product?
Thank you, Senator Brown, for the question. I think what this highlights is the need for federal oversight of the cryptocurrency industry. And as you pointed out, there have been a number of hacks and scams historically. Most of this has happened on unregulated venues. There are really sophisticated tools that the CFTC and other federal agencies have to help mitigate this risk. The CFTC has a really extensive cybersecurity and anti-hacking department and program that that all of their registrants go through, and there has been a very good track record of those companies. I think that digital asset exchanges being subject to that level of oversight would be entirely appropriate and would help to mitigate the exact risks that you're pointing to there. And I think that when you look at the instance of this that you brought up, which is scams often on rather than the platform side, but the asset side, the individual assets, that moving towards a world where there is a federal registration regime for digital assets that involve the same level of disclosure and anti-fraud protection that we see for securities today would be entirely appropriate and would help to protect against scams, Ponzi schemes, pump and dumps, and another similar activity there. I think that it will have to be a little bit different than any registration forms that currently exist, because there are some nuanced differences between digital assets and current assets, but many of the same anti-fraud principles apply in exactly the same way. And I think that having a federal oversight through that system could help address that piece of it as well.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Look forward to working with you on this. Senator Bozeman.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Ms. Boring, there are over 17,000 digital assets. Can you briefly explain what digital assets are generally used for and how they are regulated? Further, what is the real-world application of digital assets, particularly Bitcoin and Ether, which represent about 60% of the digital market? We're hearing a lot about the potential for fraud, the fraud that's going on and this and that. But tell us, so many people are confused as to what this really represents. Hearing today, we're digging a little bit deeper, but for a lot of our colleagues, this is something that, they've heard about, but they don't really understand. What's the real life purpose of getting these things?
Yeah, so to really understand the purpose of this technology, you have to understand the problem that it solves in internet architecture. So the internet was supposed to be a place for peer-to-peer transfers. It works for communications. It works for media. It does not work for things of value. So for example, if I take a picture on my cell phone and I go to send it to you peer-to-peer directly, so we're not using an intermediary for me to deliver that to you like the Postal Service, when I send it, there will be a copy of that picture on your device, and there will still be a copy of that picture on my device. Okay, great. That works for photos. That does not work for money. If I'm sending you money, it's really important that when I send it to you, it leaves my control and it's only in your custody. That is the innovation that Bitcoin solves. So that problem's called the double spending problem. And it wasn't until 2009 with the launch of Bitcoin that we knew how to do that. So previously, financial services were being retrofitted to sit on top of the internet. So you can think about this in a way of taking a picture of the front page of the Washington Post, for example, and just hosting that picture on a website. Is the news online? Technically, but are we using that infrastructure and that architecture to transform the way that we are sharing that information? No. So financial services is just now starting to see that technological boom in peer-to-peer direct transfers. So what is this used for today? There's many different cryptocurrencies, as you noted. Bitcoin has the largest market cap out of all of them, and its use is a digital store of value. The chairman of the Fed, Jerome Powell, has testified in Congress before comparing it to a digital gold. That's its main purpose. Other cryptocurrencies like Ether and proof-of-stake networks are smart contracts applications. Those are two very different things, a store of value versus smart contracts.
Very good. Thank you. If each one of you all would, this is a question for all of you, but you've only got about 30 seconds to answer it, or the chairwoman will yell at me, which is not a good thing. So I guess the question is, the heart of the matter is, do you believe it's necessary for Congress to provide market participants greater certainty when it comes to regulation of digital assets, spot markets? And if so, what should be considered as that framework is developed? And we'll start with you. Go ahead.
Ranking Member Bozeman, thank you very much for that question. In terms of what we've talked about today, I think the urgent first step is to provide the CFTC with the authorization and the resources and funding needed to oversight certain parts of the market. And it's pretty clear that derivatives and crypto derivatives fall into that, but then the next question is the spot markets with relation to what is identified and defined as commodity within the digital assets. And I'm going to emphasize that again. Not all digital assets would be commodities. It would be a subset. And making very clear what that is and that demarcation will be very important to the markets.
Okay.
But that first step alone will do wonders to really help move forward on the clarity point.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
I think that it would be great to have congressional action here, and I think providing clarity on the regulatory framework would be appropriate and helpful for the industry and for oversight. I also think that there are some actions that could be taken without a new bill passing. I think that when you look at retail commodity spot transactions with some amount of financing, that's an example of an area where I think the CFTC already has some regulatory authority, but I think for cash markets more generally, it would be great to get congressional action and clarity on that point.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
Oh, is that for me? Okay.
I'm sorry.
So our ask in terms of what this committee can do and the biggest issues impacting our space, as I stated in my oral, regulatory clarity and regulatory cohesion, to start, a good first start would be to create a joint working group between the CFTC, the SEC, and the industry. We're pleased to see that there's been bipartisan support for that, and we would further encourage that here on the Senate side as well. I mentioned the National Action Plan for Blockchain. We have 8 regulatory principles that we outline in the National Action Plan. We'd be happy to collaborate with that on you further. And we also think the CFTC is well positioned to be a lead regulator in this space.
Good. Go ahead, sir.
I would agree, Senator, with what everyone else has said, that spot market authority for crypto commodities is essential. But more broadly, Congress needs to look to where there are gaps in the regulatory structure. Not all of them are within the purview of this committee, but stablecoins are one that have been identified, central bank digital currencies, some of the energy and climate-related issues where tax policy or other methods might provide incentives, and more broadly, tax issues around digital assets are situations where it's become clear that the existing legal frameworks need some updating. And over the long term, this is the future of financial services. And so there certainly is an urgency to make these kinds of modifications, but I think Congress needs to start the process of thinking about how might we restructure fundamentally our financial regulatory system, given the kinds of innovations and changes that these technologies herald.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you
very much. Senator Booker.
Thank you, Chairwoman. I agree with so much of what's being said on both sides of the aisle about the concerns and the worries and about the urgent need for a clear regulatory framework. I want to try to highlight right now some of the things that I think are important to drive home. And so, Ms. Boring, Mr. Bankman-Fried, could you both comment on why America right now, if we're just unfurling our patriotism, is losing out on a lot of opportunity that this industry right now is mostly overseas and not here at the center of the global markets? What is the opportunities we're missing out and the dangers, in fact, of not creating a clear regulatory framework that would have these transactions and more being done here in America? If we could go, if the two of you could address that.
America, global competitiveness is a huge concern of mine. This technology, as a digital technology, does not see national borders. It's a global technology by its nature. Companies are going to operate in areas where they have legal certainty. We have members today started by Americans, U.S. small businesses. They're not comfortable operating here because they don't understand the rules of the road and they're going overseas. So having legal certainty and regulatory certainty is absolutely essential, and this committee has a key role to play in that conversation. And then, as I mentioned earlier, you have this issue of regulatory fragmentation. So the issue is not a lack of regulation, it's that you have so many cooks in the kitchen and stakeholders all pulling to have purviews over different areas of this asset class, and it adds a lot of bureaucracy and red tape to running a business here, particularly a small or medium-sized business based in digital assets in the United States. So regulatory clarity and having a cohesive strategy for businesses is essential to promoting economic growth here in the United States.
Thank you.
I agree with most of that. Thank you for the question, Senator. I think, you know, first briefly, you know, 95% of volume is offshore. Most tokens are traded exclusively offshore because of the lack of clarity today. That poses a real threat to the states. I would love to see that come back onshore. You look at the majority of digital asset transactions are conducted via U.S. dollar-backed digital assets right now, stablecoins. That could change to a different currency if the United States does not take a lead on providing a clear pathway and oversight for digital asset transactions. And you could see the center of the digital economy being somewhere other than the United States, unlike the center of most other marketplaces and economies. In terms of what I think the promise is, I think there's a ton. You look at the unbanked, the underbanked, it's not shocking that minorities disproportionately use digital assets. It's not shocking that those who don't have equitable access to our current financial infrastructure disproportionately use digital assets. It's one of the first times that people have direct access to their own finances, that people are not forced to wait 5 days for a transfer to clear, getting overdraft charges every day along the way. It's one of the first times that people can get clarity on what's going on without having to hire lots of accountants to keep track of their own ledger. And it's also, I think, something that provides a lot of hope for other areas of our economy and of our nation. I think you look at social media. I think one thing that's become clear are the dangers of having really any approaches to centralized social media control and censorship. And there are no right answers sometimes. One thing that I would be really excited to see would be blockchain technology providing an agnostic messaging protocol, which would allow interoperability between different social media platforms, break down some of the network effects, break down some of the barriers, and allow competition and allow different types of moderation to play on the same messaging protocol without holding captive the users and the content. I think that's another area where we could see real good produced by.
And so, Mr. Bankman-Fried, I'm going to interrupt you because I've only got 30 seconds left, and I'm offended that you have a much more glorious afro than I once had. So really quick. So I got into politics because as a city councilman in a neighborhood I still live in, low-income black and brown community, and I was appalled at the banking industry. And when I was mayor, we did a lot to try to disintermediate the banks. We brought Kiva into Newark to try to get direct loans. They had better repayments to Kiva loans in the banks, but they didn't use their same opportunity. I see what overdraft fees have done, and we fought with our local banks to get them to eliminate these fees. You're right that black and brown people right now are overrepresented in this space. I have concerns whenever you have large money, large industry getting into something, but could you close me out by saying to me that the best view of the future and how this could really empower the communities that all of us on this committee probably are really focused on and that I got in politics to make sure I serve.
Absolutely. I completely agree with that, Senator. I think that it could help provide direct, clear, equitable access to financial services to minorities, to economically disadvantaged, to the underbanked. It could help give them for the first time an area without discrimination from the underlying technology, and also where they have just clear transparency on what their finances are, on what their assets are, where they have control of it. They're not beholden to institutions who are charging them fees while delaying on providing services. I think you could do a lot to help serve those communities. And I think that I'm really excited for that vision of the future.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
And I hear rumors that you had a great afro back in your day too, sir.
Lots of hair. Senator Thun.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I assume that all of you are going to be the life of the Super Bowl party, because when Matt Damon comes on and says fortune favors the brave, you can start riffing about cryptocurrencies. You know it's mainstream when professional athletes, some of whom will be participating in this weekend's Super Bowl, like Odell Beckham, are getting their compensation, or at least part of their compensation, in the form of crypto. So I'm interested, obviously, as most of my colleagues are, in what's the best approach to make sure that we're not stifling innovation, but that we're regulating digital asset technology in a way that appropriately reflects the risk. So I've just asked this, Mr. Werbach, in your view, what would a risk-based approach of digital asset regulation look like?
Thank you, Senator. That's a very healthy way to look at this, because there's a variety of technologies here, And any entity involved needs to think about what are the different kinds of risks. There were some questions before about the banking system and the way that certain banks have been unwilling to take on cryptocurrency clients. And fundamentally, that should be a risk-based process in terms of assessing what are the concerns, what are the dangers here, and what are the mechanisms for addressing those kinds of concerns. It's easier to do all of that within an overarching structure where regulators provide some level of general guidance, provide some oversight and surveillance of markets, but then allow entities to devise the risk-based structures that make the most sense for them. This is actually a very diverse market with different kinds of assets, different kinds of exchanges. It's changing very fast. So a very specific prescriptive approach requiring one set of requirements may not work, but there needs to be some encouragement and some guidance about what a risk-based approach would look like. And again, that's starting to happen bottom-up in certain areas where regulators are pushing, but it needs to start with that requirement that will get participants in the industry to move forward.
Okay. Mr. Bankman-Fried and Ms. Rowan, you both make it sound like this is not the United States is not particularly competitive when it comes to attracting the digital asset industry, which begs the question about what other countries are doing and how the U.S. regulatory framework of digital assets compares with that of other countries. So could you talk about why other countries are more attractive and why the United States isn't particularly competitive? And does it have to do with a regulatory framework in those countries?
Thank you, Senator, for your question. I completely agree. Now, it's worth noting there are a lot of countries in the world. Each has a different approach, and many other countries are also not competitive on this, but many of them are. And I think the big differences that you see, it's not on whether regulation is stringent or lax. It's on whether regulation is clear or unclear. And so the biggest thing that we see with countries that have done a really good job at attracting the digital asset industry is having clarity from the regulators about what licenses one should be pursuing, about what the oversight is on those, who the overseeing body is, about how one registers things that need to be registered. Providing a pathway forward with sufficient oversight is the hallmark of the countries that have done very well at this. And I think the biggest struggle in the United States, patchwork is a word that's been used a few times here. It is the patchwork of regulation that there is simultaneously too many sort of cooks in the kitchen and yet not enough oversight because there's a diffusion of responsibility. I think that having a clear framework with clearly communicated, whether they're prescriptive guidelines or maybe more appropriately principles-based guidelines, but a clear regulator in charge of those or their cooperation between regulators on it, clear licensing and registration pathways that are not lax, but that are clear, I think is the single biggest thing that's missing.
If I may add to that, thank you, Senator. There are two countries I want to highlight that we may want to borrow part of their playbook, maybe not all their playbook. Switzerland. FINMA is a regulator that has been very early to be very clear about how things are defined. Whether something is a utility token or a security token, whatever token it is, they have made very clear definitions. Further, they have come out in front on how they deem different classifications of activities and what falls under their oversight or not. They were also one of the first to come out with a licensing regime for these crypto funds. And this is what happens when you do that. There is a little town called Zug, Crypto Valley. It has that name. No one ever heard of Zug 8 years ago, but it is now home to hundreds, if not thousands, of crypto companies. These people do not all live there, but they have set up shop there. And I think that's something we should think about. Okay. Estonia. I will leave you with Estonia. That one's an interesting one as well. They have an e-resident program, and they have digitized a large chunk of their government services. What's interesting as an entrepreneur about setting up in Estonia, I don't need to go there either. I need to prove my identity. I need to obviously have the requisite capital to invest. but everything else I can do digitally. Hmm. I can even have encrypted signatures for legal documents. It's a very interesting model. And so we should be looking at those types of things to encourage business to come here. They don't necessarily physically have to come here, but to set up shop and to create jobs here.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. Chairman, if I could just have Ms. Boring take this one for the record, because my time's expired and I have to run over and vote. But you mentioned examples of blockchain technology in use today, and in particular, I appreciate you pointing out applications in agriculture. You mentioned livestock ownership, record-keeping use, and I'd like to have you, if you could, for the record, tell us more about that use and how it affects American farmers and ranchers.
Yeah, happy to, and thank you for the question. So blockchain technology is providing security and transparency to supply chains, and it's ultimately arming our farmers, ranchers, as well as consumers with better information and data about agriculture products. One example of this is a company called Beef Chain. They're based in Wyoming. They're a small business here in the US, and they're a pioneer of this technology. So cattle is tagged with an RFID and given a unique digital identifier. That cattle's unique ID, as well as other information that it's that's collected throughout the supply chain, such as where it was born, has it received hormones or not, when it was sold, where it was sold, all that information is collected, secured, and stored using blockchain technology. Supply chains are creating, blockchain technology is bringing other benefits to supply chains, such as making them more efficient. It's helping increase trust in different brands, especially small farmers and ranchers here throughout the US. It's helping with sustainability goals, food freshness, food safety, helps prevent fraud as well as food waste.
Thank you, and thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you all for being here. Appreciate your insight.
Senator Braun.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As an entrepreneur and business owner, probably most fresh off the street here in the Senate, this is an interesting area to me. I'm also came from the world of economics so long ago. Talk about a lot of that stuff, including our budget that is now the worst it's ever been in the history of our country, $1.5 trillion a year, gives a lot of fuel for non-sovereign currencies and some of the stuff that anybody would be worried about, where we've been the reserve currency for so long due to some of the predictability. When we used to balance our budgets, when we used to not have inflation, I won't get into that, it would take up too much time. I've got a question about the new technology. I'll start with Ms. Boring. When it comes to Elon Musk, who loves the idea of all of this, but quit accepting cryptocurrency due to the environmental impact, is there something down the road that would, through economy of scale, make the energy use less, you know, for all the benefits that it looks like it may give us sometime, someday, because that's going to be an increasingly significant issue. What is your take on that? And do you believe Elon Musk had something there in citing how energy intensive and expensive it is to establish blockchain?
Yeah, it's been thank you for the question. It's been interesting to see Elon Musk's stance of digital assets. While they decided to stop accepting certain digital assets, they still own it and it still sits on Tesla's balance sheet. So I think actions speak as a part of the approach as well. Specific to energy concerns, we have seen a number of groups and people and members of Congress express concerns about the energy uses of certain digital assets, specifically those that use proof of work. The point that I made earlier is what's important about what we're seeing in the Bitcoin mining industry and other proof of work blockchains is that this industry is leading the transition to renewables. We represent companies that are publicly traded and listed here in the United States that are partnered with renewable plants like solar and wind throughout the U.S. These partnerships between the renewable industry and the Bitcoin mining industry is bringing new investments and innovation into renewables. And that needs to be an incredibly important part of the conversation as we look at policy responses to this concern.
So I think when you look at what a small percentage it is currently of transactions, and with the increasing emphasis on maybe the cleanest, least expensive fuel, I think down the road, hopefully, both of those converge in the right direction. I think there's going to be plenty of demand for something in addition to sovereign currencies that look a little shaky and risky for, you know, what the dependability was there in the past. I got a question for Mr. Wirbach. When it comes to this emerging technology, kind of analogous to the internet, and we didn't know where that was going to go, and look where it has come. Now its biggest susceptibility is from cyber thieves. And I think many would wonder about using blockchain and cryptocurrencies, you know, when it's in that realm of, can it be hacked? Is it something that can give you peace of mind and security for all the reasons, you know, I've mentioned already? How do you draw a comparison between this and the internet in terms of concerns, fledgling industry, and then what about its long-term safety and security when it's based upon a technology that many of us don't know much about?
Senator, it's a very important question. And we forget that back in the 1990s, people said, how would you buy something on the internet? You mean you're going to type in your credit card number to a computer and it's going to go off somewhere in the ether and you're going to believe that someone's not going to steal your credit card? Americans were worried about e-commerce for exactly that reason, and to some extent for good reason. What happened? Part of what happened was technology evolved. There were various technical mechanisms to ensure that your credit card is protected. Part of it is regulation, that there's oversight of the credit card industry. So if, in fact, your credit card is stolen, your entire balance is not at risk. It's capped by the issuers. And part of it had to do with regulation and oversight of these industries as a consumer protection matter. So ultimately, people got confident. I focus on the idea of trust. That's what's in the title of my book. And that's the similarity. People learned to trust the internet as they had good experiences with it. And the same thing is possible here. The ironic thing is that the blockchain technology itself is incredibly secure. It's cryptographically secured. Bitcoin is $1 trillion at its peak in assets, and no one has successfully been able to hack that ledger because it's so secure based on the underlying cryptographic structures. The problem, though, is that you holding keys at the edge of the network, you have to secure your own keys. You can't rely on the bank or the intermediary providing all that security. And that is what has opened up the opportunity for all these hacks. So again, we need to move forward with industry working and identifying technologies and best practices, as well as having oversight and regulatory mechanisms to ensure that there are basic standards.
Thank you. Interesting new horizons, I'd say.
Senator Tuberville.
Thank you, Senator Bozeman. Thanks for being here today. I think you'll all agree that it's critical for the United States to be the undisputed leader in the digital asset game. Up to this point, we have led the world in financial innovation. Under the previous administration, regulators understood the importance of encouraging innovation and took a light-touch regulatory approach to the digital assets industry. We've seen a dramatic shift over the course of the past year, and I'm concerned about the regulation of enforcement mentality that is starting to take hold. If this keeps up, innovators are going to leave the U.S. and move overseas to places like the U.K. and Singapore. We can't let that happen, and we certainly can't allow China to get ahead of us in the financial innovation. So, Sam, you built a great company and had tremendous success. I'm a free market guy who happens to think that's a good thing. What do regulators and those of us serving in Congress need to do to keep companies like yours operating in the United States, and how can we encourage more innovation here?
Thank you, Senator, for the question and for the kind words. I completely agree that it is imperative that we allow the current industry to stay here and hopefully much of the current offshore industry to move back into the United States as well. Again, we're in a situation where 95% of volume is offshore today, and it would be great to see a lot of that move back into the United States. The biggest things that we need are regulatory clarity. And again, it's not so much a matter of are regulations like stringent or lax. It's much more a question of are they clear and is there a regulatory pathway forward for registration and licensing? To maybe name a few specific areas there, getting clarity on the cash cryptocurrency markets, the spot markets would be really great for the industry. Much of the institutional capital is sitting on the sidelines waiting for that. I think the CFTC would be an appropriate regulator for spot digital commodity transactions. I think a second thing, and this is one of the bigger things, is on the token registration. A lot of activity is taking place outside of the United States right now because there's not a clear registration process for tokens in the United States. I think it is appropriate to have a registration process, to have anti-fraud controls and other similar things that we see in other marketplaces. But you know, you can't just exactly copy-paste the registration process for a security or something like that to a digital asset because there are some differences, even if many of the same principles do still apply. And so I think a similar principles-based system, but one which acknowledges the unique aspects of digital assets and can provide that same clarity but allow them to actually register in the United States and be offered on U.S. platforms would be really important for bringing a lot of the industry back onshore because, again, most tokens are not accessible at all in the United States because there is no clear registration pathway today. So I think that those are two of the biggest things to address, and I think addressing those two plus a regulatory framework for stablecoins, which I think is going to be coming to a head soon, and I think having some sort of auditing framework for it as well, would do an enormous amount to provide clarity so that people could get licensed in the United States, could get registered here, and could conduct their business activity here rather than going to jurisdictions outside of here who had developed frameworks for it.
Yeah, thank you. Of the thousands of digital assets out there, what percentage would each of you say are commodities versus securities? And I'd like for everybody to just give an estimate. Ms. Rowe?
There are so many that are out there. I think the digital asset definition basically means any asset that's digitized. And so if we take a subset of the different classifications, you have to put aside all of the CBDC, central bank digital currencies. That's another category. You've got your tokenized physical things, as I like to call them. So when you tokenize or digitize real estate or gold or actual physical things, that is its own asset class, or that is its own subcategory, and they have their own kind of demarcations depending on what physical thing they are. Some of the rest could actually probably fall under the commodities bucket, and that's where it gets complicated. So I can't give you an exact percentage, but I would start classifying things into sub-buckets, and then we'll be able to parse out how much of that is actually commodities.
Sam?
If you weight by volume or market cap, I think the vast majority of activity is in commodities. If you instead weight by number of tokens, I think that some of them are clearly commodities. I think some of them are unclear and have some properties of a number of different asset classes and don't neatly fit into any bucket. And so I think it's sort of a split by those if you look at number of token rather than market cap or volume.
Ms. Boring?
Yeah, I agree with Mr. Bankman-Fried. If you go by market cap, the vast majority are commodities. Bitcoin and Ether today compose over 60% of the market capitalization of the entire digital asset ecosystem, and they've been defined as a commodity by the CFTC today. There's other categories. We kind of talked about categories of digital assets. Another one is intentional digital asset securities. That's another area that's a nascent and emerging piece of the ecosystem, but has yet to really fully be realized because of the lack of regulatory clarity by the policymakers.
Digital assets don't have a fundamental attribute. The question is how they're used. And so, too, the vast majority of digital assets are used in investment schemes, are used as a form of fundraising, which is the attributes under the Howey test of a security. But there are situations that are in the middle. Ether, the SEC has suggested, is a commodity today, but may well have been a security when it was originally issued back in 2014, 2015. Bitcoin, because there's no entity that is issuing Bitcoin that is raising money, makes sense to think about it as a commodity. You're not contributing to some investment scheme through the efforts of others. It's a decentralized network. So I would agree with what the other speakers have said about if you just look at the market today. But the important question is really what's going on? What's the nature of the activity that's involved? That's going to change and develop. And the same asset may, in different circumstances, be in more than one category.
Thank you. Thank you for such a complex issue that we're all heading towards, and your expertise, and thanks for coming here today, Senator Bozeman.
Thank you very much, and again, a special thanks to all of our witnesses and our committee members and staff for really a very informative hearing that I think has helped us as we go forward. On behalf of Senator Stabenow and myself, as you can see, there are no shortage of questions on this issue. We appreciate your testimony, which will help us get a better grasp on the potential and the risk of digital assets. As of now, there's a gap in the oversight of digital assets. This poses a danger to the American consumers and could threaten the resiliency of our financial markets if left unchecked. I want to reiterate that regulation and innovation are not mutually exclusive, and that's what we're all working to achieve. We have an opportunity here to broaden participation in our financial markets, but this must be paired with consistent rules of the road that protect investors and our markets. You've given us a lot to consider, and we look forward to further discussions in this committee. And with that, that concludes our hearing today. The record will remain open until tomorrow at 5 o'clock p.m. for members to submit additional questions or statements. And with that, the hearing is adjourned.